Sir, and good morning everyone. So Dr. Mansi has made my work easy actually, and a lot of pathophysiology part has been covered, and I think there is not much need to discuss it, that we all know that coronavirus, the SARS-CoV-2 is a this novel coronavirus is named as COVID-19, and there have been two previous epidemics of a similar nature, one by the SARS-CoV and other by the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome. And those who are at greater risk of developing complications and sequelae include those having comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, CKD, cardiovascular disease, and those having malignancies. A spectrum of disease, most of the people are asymptomatic, and it is only around 4 or 5% people who are having severe cases or mortality associated with the disease. Extrapulmonary manifestations could be several, which are involving different systems like neurological system, renal, hepatic, GI, thromboembolus, cardiac, endocrine, dermatological. And so in this, I shall be focusing on the nervous system per se. And the reason for involvement of the nervous system is thought to be because of either the breakdown of the blood-brain barrier and leading to the hematogenesis spread, and the other is transneuronally using the olfactory system, and the virus may cross through the ribriform plate and reach the brain. The hematogenous route is the this shows how the hematogenesis spread takes place, and this the olfactory nerve is seen to be involved, and then later on the brain is involved because of this retrograde spread. Then there is another thing, which is the enteric nervous system, which is also involved, and the antigen presenting cells can take this inflammation to the gut associated lymphoid tissue, and thus the GI may also be and GI nervous system may also be involved. So coronavirus per se contains a spike glycoprotein receptor, which is helpful in adhering to the host cell, and the host cell in turn contains the ACE, that is angiotensin converting enzyme receptor, and these are the two essential, mainly these are the two essential things which are needed for infection, though there are other things like proteases, the TMPR SS2 enzyme, which is also responsible for increase facilitating this process, and then there is the replication and things like that. So it is seen that the oligodendrocyte precursor cells, they mainly contain these ACE2 receptors and TMPR SS2 receptors, though the neurons and microglia do not have these receptors. And in the presence of diabetes and hypertension, this ACE2 receptor expression is increased in the brain, leading to increased neurotropism of the virus. In the early phases, there could be an inflammatory response which is localized to the part of the to certain areas of the respiratory tract itself, mucosa, which could lead to things like anosmia and also leading to altered taste. Then comes the pulmonary phase, in which may involve the nervous system by causing coagulopathy, and then comes the third phase, which is the inflammatory response phase, in which, because of the cytokine is strong, the nervous system is an involvement of all the different organs, multiple organ involvement, nervous system is also likely to be affected. So depending on the different phases, it is basically the nervous system involvement starts right from the incubation, may start right from the incubation period in which the nasal mucosa is involved, and it may continue even till the late pulmonary phase when there is an immune dysregulation which is taking place in the body. Different things like the presence of coagulopathy can lead to a stroke. The presence of cytokine storm can lead to multiple involvement of the different organs, including the nervous system, because of increased vascular permeability. Autoimmunity can also lead to certain, because of molecular mimicry between the particles of the composition of the virus and the parts of the nervous system. It can lead to ADEM, acute encephalomyelitis, and GBS like picture, and ACE2 down regulation can lead to further increase in the incidence of stroke. Now, so the coagulopathies can lead to stroke. Cytokine storm has been seen in these patients, leading to lymphopenia, increased neutrophils. And it is seen that the marker of the cytokine storm is ferritin. So the people who have increased ferritin level, that may indicate this eminent storm. And so they may be at more risk of developing complications, including the sequelae. Then autoimmunity, we have discussed that it can lead to different neurological manifestations. The common neurological manifestations include things like seizures, involvement of the meningoencephalitis, and some uncommon things. And the common things include insomnia, headache, and muscle pains, anosmia, ageusia. And uncommon things may include things like GBS, Miller-Fisher syndrome, the rhabdomyolysis, ADEM, and even the Press syndrome. Stroke, people have found various things. Now, stroke, it is not exactly clear whether stroke per se is the result of the increased thrombolysis or because of comorbidities, but then there is definitely increased risk of ischemic stroke in these people. Including intracranial hemorrhage, though it is lesser in number in comparison to ischemic events, but in ICU, the risk can be as high as stroke can be as high as 6%. And these are the MRI pictures which have been seen in people having COVID associated with stroke. And usually the onset of a stroke occurs 1 to 3 weeks after onset of COVID symptoms. Now, the reason why I'm discussing these is that all these complications, these events which occur in cases of following COVID or associated with COVID, they can lead to sequelae. And then, so the recognition and management of these is important. The stroke the residual deficits can persist till long. Seizures, a person can have seizures because of different things like metabolic alterations or because of certain actual meningoencephalitis has also been documented rarely. The febrile seizures can also occur, and that can be managed by using paracetamol. Meningoencephalitis, many of these patients who have developed meningoencephalitis, it has been seen that they appear to respond to immunotherapy, including high-dose corticosteroids. ADEM or even acute hemorrhagic necrotizing encephalopathy has been reported. There have been certain reports. And again, those people have recovered with high-dose steroids, intravenous immunoglobulins, or plasma exchange, as in the cases of which is the usual treatment for these conditions. But then some people have died, especially those having severe hemorrhagic necrotizing illness. Generalized myoclonus, because of hypoxia and so many other things, can be a post-infectious complication. And so the things which are usually used for the treatment of myoclonus, like levetiracetam, valproate, they have been found to be effective, and also immunotherapy. Press syndrome has also been reported, but then since it is supposed to be a reversible condition, so people have developed the changes have been reversed, but then long term, there are very less reports of these patients, so exact data is not clear. Cranial neuropathies can result, so the involvement of CNS and peripheral nervous system both are quite common. The treatment of GBS is similar to that of cases of the other cases. Now, GBS usually appears within 1 or 2 weeks following this illness. Cases have been seen in the first week itself. Majority of these are demyelinating cases, and the treatment is similar to that of the usual GBS. It is known that GB syndrome patients can have residual weakness, and they can take long time, even up to 6 months to 1 year for complete recovery. So that those things need management, including physiotherapy and team efforts. And then a thing, important thing is rhabdomyolysis. So if it is CPK is elevated in these patients, and if this could be a severe complication, but if the muscle pain or severe myalgias or muscle weakness persists, then it can cause a problem, as we will discuss in the subsequent slides. Myasthenia also, there have been three patients have been diagnosed to have in Italy. Three patients have been diagnosed to have myasthenia gravis in this antibody positive myasthenia gravis, and that was reported up to 5 to 7 days after COVID. But it is not exactly clear, it is an association per se, and the treatment which is immunotherapy may be effective. But then for long-term immunosuppression or using this oral agents like rituximab, etc., the body needs to recover and that they can be delayed. So this has all been history now. And what is new latest is the post-COVID-19 neurological syndrome or PCNS, and the things which are persisting after the acute phase is over. And the neurological problems have been seen in around quite high number of people, and all the things which are leading, which are the acute complications, they can persist for longer time, including the stroke deficits, loss of smell and taste. Usually that recovers in 1 to 3 weeks, but then people have been reporting these deficits up to 3 to 6 months also. Neuromuscular things like myalgia and fatigue are persisting. Myocarditis has already been discussed by the previous speaker. The neurocognitive deficits may persist, which may be quite bothersome to the working population. Hypercoagulable states may persist. And then not to forget are the psychiatric complications like depression and anxiety, including the post-traumatic stress disorder, which has also been seen in quite high number of people. And then an important thing is the ICU-related symptoms. So once a person has been admitted to ICU, they can develop the critical illness, neuropathy and myopathy per se, which can lead to a very prolonged recovery. And then ICU-related complications can also lead to weakness because of malnutrition and things like that. Now, it is seen that psychological distress is seen in around 50% of the patients during admission because of social stigmatization, which has been seen in many cases. So the survivors of this critical illness can develop depression, anxiety, and PTSD. So a lot of support from the family members, from the community, doctors, and the psychiatrists and people, other team members is also essential. The post-COVID in this ICU admission can lead to loss of muscle mass and diaphragmatic weakness. It can lead to difficulty in swallowing. Also, dysphagia has been reported. And then the things like bed sores and contractures can result once a person is admitted. So they also need proper physiotherapy and management. A thing called dysexecutive syndrome has been seen in quite a high number of people, around 36% of people in our study. And this means that people can have difficulty in executing the functions because of certain, there have been some MRI changes like involving the frontal lobes, which have been found in these people, but they have been in these case reports per se, and some of them do not have hyperintensities in the brain, but they still have problem in executing their tasks. Chronic fatigue syndrome is a thing which is being
finished in another 2 minutes. Two more minutes, yes. Please.
Yes. So the chronic fatigue syndrome is a thing which is, and there are several names for this syndrome, and it is found that maybe it is the pathophysiology is thought to be because of involvement of the G lymphatic system leading to certain blockage of the nasal CSF outflow pathway, and people are hypothesizing that CSF drainage could help in removing these waste from the brain, and it could lead to help in chronic fatigue syndrome, but that needs to be further investigated. And it is not related to the severity of COVID-19. People having pre-existing depression and anxiety, and females per se have been found to have greater chances of developing post-viral chronic fatigue syndrome. Myelitis has been seen persisting in these patients. So it is seen that COVID-19 targets, different targets expressed in the brain are responsible for these manifestations, and increased chances of inflammation. These inflammatory markers may be important guides as to what course to follow in these people. Rehabilitation is a core, and there is a lot more to the problem which is yet to be discovered. But then, and therapeutics are same as in most of the cases of COVID, acute COVID, it is the same. And the neurological manifestations are quite an important part of these people. having these symptoms. And the neuropathological features have been seen in autopsies, including different areas of the brain having certain thrombovasculitis. And then virus has been detected in several people. So ADM like lesions have also been reported in some patients. Hence, because of shortage of time, I shall wind up. And early diagnosis and management is the key to manage these early detection by using inflammatory markers, and early diagnosis and then management of these people, including a proper team support, is the key to the management of these patients. And with this, I would like to wind up and thank you very much for the opportunity and attention.